Welcome to a new edition of the Neon Jazz Interview Series with award-winning and multiple JONO-nominated jazz and world artist, Sundar Viswanathan. He opened up about his new 2021 CD, Worldview, done with the award-winning world jazz group featuring a cohort of some of Toronto's finest jazz, world, funk, and pop musicians known as Avatar. The music is inspired by the deep musical traditions of India, Africa, and Brazil, and rooted within the framework of modern jazz. He was born in India and raised in a musical family, and his household was filled with the sounds of Indian classical and popular music and Western pop and country artists. He would grow up to become one of Canada's most diversely talented artists, a highly respected international musical ambassador and educator. Enjoy the story.
Hey, thanks for taking a minute out, man.
Not a problem. My pleasure.
Great to meet you. Great to talk to you. And first and foremost, Worldview. What a great album. What a great time to bring out an album like this with so many cats and such a rich sound. Talk to me a little bit about it's coming out as we're going through this pandemic and coming out of it. What does it mean for this album to come out now?
Well, you know, I think the pandemic and circumstances around the world shaped the album. So I think it goes both ways. I don't think this album could have come out in the way it is if these things hadn't happened and hadn't inspired, you know, certain perspectives on music for me. I guess one of my goals is that some of the messages that I sort of talk about and present in the music is just people understand it and they resonate with it, because so many things happened from the pandemic and so many things are happening culturally, socially, politically in the world in the past several years. I just couldn't put an album out that didn't reflect on it. So I think they really tie into each other, the fact that the pandemic came out with all the other accompanying things and then that the album happened to come out as well now.
Talk to me a little bit about what you hope the listener gets from this experience. There's a lot of voices from a lot of different parts of the world. There's a very nice collective going on here. What are you hoping the listener gets?
You know, it's fundamental. I think what's really important, I think, for me that the listener gets out of it is that we need to treat each other better. We need to treat our children. We need to put the world, we need to position this world, and we need to develop this world in a way that's a world that children can look forward to growing up in. They're not afraid to grow up in. They're not, people aren't afraid to go out because there's violence here, violence there. And, you know, they see the world, the environment too, you know, that they're able to grow up in the world, that they feel that they're going to be able to have the things we had when we were growing up in terms of nature, you know, just to be very straight with it. So, yeah, I just think it's important. I want people to just think about how they want to... how their actions impact our most important citizens, the children, and what we can do to make this world a better place for them.
So over this pandemic, what did you learn about yourself that maybe you didn't realize before that's going to make you stronger as you get out into the world and, you know, start promoting this album and perform live?
Wow, that's a pretty heavy question. Wow, think about that for just a second. Well, I mean, I think because I had the time to sit and just reflect, and you know, everyone I think did was forced that time upon them. So we were in our own spaces and had to learn about ourselves. I just realized that, you know, life doesn't happen independently for me as much as maybe I thought. Like I rely on people, and I realize how important people are to my life and in my life and in the trajectory of my life and where things are going. I realized that maybe I'm not as strong as I thought I was. I need other people to help me with stuff, you know?
You're a multi-instrumentalist, saxophone, vocalist. You're all over the place. You're very talented. How did the tentacles of jazz grab you? How did you get into music? And more specifically, how did jazz become your life?
I always loved music. Music was always happening around the family. My mom's side of the family, I was just telling a friend yesterday, mom's side of the family was very musical. And he said, oh, but what about your dad's side? And I said, oh, my dad's side couldn't carry music. He put it in a bag for them and, you know, handed it to them. You know, it was funny. But I got it from my mom's side. There was always music around the house, playing music. My uncles had bands. So I was listening to their bands. And I grew up in that environment. So music was almost just a thing that was always there. I never kind of thought about going into music as a profession because, you know, in my culture, South Asian culture, that's not a thing that you really gear your kids towards, or at least traditionally, right? Music was there, and as I got into university, I was going to be a computer scientist, and math wasn't my strongest suite, And I realized that maybe that wasn't the way to go. And I sort of fell into music. I ended up going to music school. And then it was classical in the beginning because I didn't know anything from jazz or classical. I just happened to go to school where I studied classical, saxophone, and composition. Then I started hearing, you know, the first recording I ever heard that really, really blew me away was Charlie Parker with strings. So when I heard that, I was like, oh my, listen to what he's doing. He's like, he's soaring, he's flying. I really want to be able to do that one day. So then I started listening deeply to jazz and started checking it out, transcribing it. And that was my foot in. And then from there, I studied quite a bit. I studied with people and just did homework and got more deeply into it, and also the world aspects too. So,
what was the first live jazz show you saw that really blew you away?
You know what? I'm thinking back, and what I can remember of one of the first shows that I probably saw was I was living in a town outside Toronto, and I took a bus and a train, etc., to get to Toronto to get to hear Joe Henderson. Joe Henderson was playing at a small club. It blew my mind. I mean, just hearing his sound, and then I got to talk to him and sit down with him for a minute afterwards. And I think I remember that one show. It was Joe Henderson with some local guys. Just blew me away.
What do you like the best about being a professional musician? You know, every day you get to wake up, you can create music and give something to people that's very necessary and needed. What do you like the best about this process?
Well, what you said is a lot of it. I mean, I think I wake up every day and I don't despair my job. I mean, I look forward to going to work and doing my stuff. And then, you know, it's those moments really when I teach a student. For instance, I have a student, cause I teach as well, right? And you know, one side of it, the teaching thing, when I teach students something and then they come back to me many years later and they thank me and they've done really well. I have a student who's doing really well, who's my student, you know, a long time ago. I would say how long ago, but more than 10 years ago. And he's out in the scene now and he's one of the cats. And it's so great to see him and hear him. And you know, he comes up to me and he thanks me for some things. And it's nice to hear some people do so well and you've inspired some people. And then, of course, the performing end of things, you know, going and doing a show. And then at the end of the show, even just one person coming up and saying, you know, I heard you. I heard what you were saying. And it's not just, you know, the music sounded really good or whatever, but I heard what you were saying. I heard the message and, you know, it moved me. That's, you know, that's so important to me, is to hear that it moves other people. And I'm able to do what feels good in my body, in my heart, and then that other people get it, you know?
You know, the one thing too, that you've been around some pretty heavy cats. You've been around Wynton Marsalis, Dave Douglas, Lee Konitz, Joe Lovano, Chris Potter, the list goes on and on. What did they give you, whether directly or indirectly, that you in turn have taken and given to the younger players that you're around or those that you educate?
Yeah, that's another great question. I just thought of one thing as you said that, and I could sum it up in one word. I think they've shown me humility. I mean, all of them are such fantastic players, but they've all been like, you know, they understand that, you know, they don't talk and act like they're great. They just, they have humility and they can still grow. And that's why I couldn't believe it from these people, that these people are the pinnacle of great artists and they're still able to, you know, have humility and be humble. And just to, you know, so when I go to my students, you know, I remember when I was a kid, I remember when I was studying and there was moments when I, you know, recorded something and I was so proud of myself. And not that it's wrong to be proud of what you've done, but, you know, I thought I was, you know what, right? And I wasn't, absolutely wasn't. And I realize that now, the more I know, the less I know. You know, the more I know, the less I know. That just, I think, is so important for young people to realize that you got to learn from everybody. You've never reached the goal.
You know, you've won awards and you've been Juno nominated. You've had lots of things happen to recognize your work. And I don't really want to know what your favorite one was. That's never a fair question. But more than that, what surprised you the most? What award or nomination did you get that just totally was unexpected?
Well, probably the Juno Awards with a band that I play with called Jaffa Road. And that we didn't expect that. I mean, that was a really great treat. And for us to travel there and feel like we're, you know, big time, you know, walking with pop musicians and whatever, and in the same, you know, in the same pathway, and people asking for an autograph. Now, wow, that was, yeah, I felt really special in that moment. It's just, you know, we're just, you know, jazz world musicians. We're not like Justin Bieber, you know, because we felt like it, though. We felt pretty important in those moments. So that was pretty cool.
You know, as we start returning to the stage, what are you looking forward to the most, or what are you hoping that we all collectively realize about this absence of live music, both musician and the fans?
The very fact that we're able to go back and hear it, and it doesn't feel the same as putting on your record player and sitting down and listening to it. There are so many more things that you experience, and the physicality of hearing live music in front of you is so important. And I think people will realize that it's not the same to buy records. You got to go out, and I mean, if people are buying records anymore, I guess it's not the same to just listen to music in space. But you got to go out and hear and see the musicians in front of you, and look at the interaction, and feel the sound as it vibrates the air around you. You know, I think that's so important. And we miss that with the easy accessibility of music that we've had over the past number of years.
You know, the one thing I used to ask before the pandemic was, how strong is the world of jazz? How strong is the community? And I don't have to ask that anymore, because COVID erased so many itineraries that was evidence of that. But when you look at where we're at now after all of this, and the dust is kind of settling, so to speak, because we're getting back to live music, how much stronger do you think the community is going to be because of what you've gone through?
I think once we settle, wipe the dust off and start getting things start to flow, I think this community is going to be quite strong. Unfortunately, I think some people, the 2 years of absence was too much for them, and they gave in and they gave up, and that's really unfortunate. But I think it's going to take time, but I think eventually we're going to come back. I have optimism that the community is going to be stronger than ever. My concern is around the economics of it, and economics of venues and that kind of thing. I hope that it comes back to where it was before. We'll see. I can't really make a call on that, but I think philosophically, I think we're all, you know, those of us who are really like determined are going to make it happen and do well with it, hopefully.
So why do you love jazz?
I guess it's just, you know, it's such a freeing vehicle for me. It just lets me express things that I'm feeling through the language of jazz. And jazz has such a evolving and varied language. I mean, this album is a combination of jazz and other world, you know, musics. So it's not like jazz is just, swing in 4/4. It's moving to so many places, and jazz reflects, it's really able to reflect you as a human being, as a jazz artist, as a composer. And that's one thing I really love about it, is that if I'm feeling a certain way or in a certain part of my life, I can write it and then try to play it. So jazz is really all musics, you know, put together for me.
So if you could get into a time machine and go back in time and see any jazz musician at any period, who would you want to see live?
Oh, man, I would love to see Train. I mean, Coltrane, I wish I could spend some time with him. Again, speaking about humility and greatness. You know, there's a guy I would like to, you know, talk to and hug. You know, he's a guy I don't like to say there's idols, but if there was an idol, he'd be one of my idols.
Yeah, there would be a long line for that, for sure.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So everyone has a perception of you, your family, your friends, your fans, your students, but ultimately you are living your life. Who do you think you are?
Oh, boy. Wow. Good question, Joe. Man, I don't know. You know, that's a problem. I start thinking, this is going to get a little philosophical, but when I start to think who I am, that's when the problem comes in. If I just go with it and just feel what feels good and go with what feels right, then I think that's where I'm going to get to who I am. Because if I start to, this is the thing, if I start to say I'm a jazz musician, you know, then I'm not really a jazz musician. I'm also this, I'm also that, I'm also a dad, you know, I'm also a citizen, and I'm also somebody who loves all kinds of other things in life. So I think it's just, I'm someone who's changing all the time. I'm trying to get to that space. Let's put it that way. I mean, it's really hard. I think for me, my goal is to be able to get to a place where I don't think I'm any particular thing.
You know, I've spent many hours interviewing musicians over the pandemic. And the one thing that I love about what's happening right now during this period is things are opening up and we're actually talking about live gigs. So I'm curious, how do you see your world of live gigs and things unfolding as we go through the end of this year into next?
Yeah, well, there's the reality that, okay, the festival season comes up in the summer. There's a reality that a lot of the gigs that are set up for the festival season are going to be backlogged. So there's going to be a backlog of stuff. So I see myself sort of planning for, you know, I'll plan for next year, but also the following year. A lot of things I want to do. I mean, I have a lot of goals to get into other areas. We've done some nice things and some touring out west in Canada and also South Africa. And I want to get into Europe and into the States more with this band. I mean, I've been touring in a lot of places around the world with other bands and things, but not this band. So I just have at the list of places where, you know, follow through with, and I want to get our presence in other parts of, you know, international touring. That's what's really exciting me, because I see how people look at music. It's a bit different in other parts of the world sometimes, and I feel like we're really going to be accepted. This music's going to be accepted in Europe and other parts of the U.S.
Beautiful, man. Hey, thank you for taking some time out for the show today. Good luck with the album and the return to the stage. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Joe. I appreciate it, too.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to another Neon Jazz interview, where we give you a bit of insight into the finest players in India, Toronto, Kansas City, and spots all over the world, giving fans all that jazz. And thanks to Sundar for his time, music, and story. If you want to hear more interviews, go to Famous Interviews with Joe Domino in the iTunes Store. Visit NeonJazz at YouTube.com, and for everything Neon Jazz all the time, go to the NeonJazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, enjoy the jazz, my friends.
Neon Jazz.